Greater Expectations by Allan R. Manchester. Narrated by Mandy Kaplan. Published by Ex Libris. This program was produced by Ex Libris. Text copyright 2018 by Allan R. Manchester. Production copyright 2021 by Allan R. Manchester. All rights reserved. Foreword. This is not a sequel to Charles Dickens' book. This book started as two, a work of philosophy entitled How to Stop a Hurricane and Some Other Things You Might Like to Know, and a novel called Starship Holly. After finishing the novel, I considered the long-term ramifications of the philosophy and the novel. I expect these works together to dramatically change the world of mankind. I was pondering the promotion of the books together, but then I decided to sell the two works as one. Greater Expectations is exactly what I have for these works, this work. I expect this work to be the foundation of the world of tomorrow. No more war, crime, poverty, or bigotry. You may say I'm a dreamer, but no, I'm a realist. I logically decimate the works of Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, Newton, Maxwell, Einstein, Plato, Aristotle, Darwin, Nietzsche, Adam Smith, J.M. Keynes, and all philosophies that are built upon these great thinkers. Not possible, you say? But here it is. A world of prosperity and peace? Here it is. So the title, Greater Expectations. If the results are as I expect, this work will quickly supplant the Bible, the Quran, and all historical theological works. I expect that no future child of 10 will be ignorant of this work 100,000 years from now. And I do expect that mankind will still be reading these words 200 million years from now, not just on Earth. I do expect that the Creator has surprises for us, hidden out there in the stars. I expect to still be living when we start to find them, these new Earths and their secrets. If this work does not upset your worldview, then you have not read the work carefully enough. Everyone hates to have their worldview upset, and I am sorry to have to do this to you. But bigotry must die. All worldviews that I have encountered, whether academic or theological, harbor bigotry. And so now I need to throw over the way you have been thinking and lead you to a new course. Sorry for the pain this may cause, and you are welcome for the future this will bring. Starship Holly. First launch. Eric had been sitting here on his couch for 4 Earth hours, waiting for his module to gain its own inertia from the intensifying magnetic field pushing against every strand of gravity within this box, which was to be the core of the fledgling new Starship Holly. I'll be glad when we're airborne. Patience much? Eric replied to his co-pilot. And if we catch any air, we'll never know about it, but the rest of the world will. Okay then, spaceborne, Vince whined. And the theory is that we could catch a snag in Earth's atmosphere without any damage? Maybe so, but I'd like to see those theoreticians prove their theories on their own butts and not mine. Great timing to be expressing that sentiment, Vince laughed. Eric mused. Yeah, Vince was bang on with that comment. They were on the moon, about to be fired out of a cannon at 0.51 times the speed of light. If Percival was wrong in his theories about magnetic effects on inertia, Eric just might catch a glimpse of his own brains as his eyeballs flattened against the back of his skull. The theory was that all inertia and timing is dependent upon the gravitation of all the mass surrounding an object through the gravitational connections. Magnetism is a corruption of gravity, so by pushing magnetic fields into the holly, it was getting isolated from the prevailing inertial fields in a way that made instant acceleration possible. The inertia of a lightning bolt will completely destroy a large tree, yet the trajectory changes in mid-air, making the jagged arc only because the electrons are in a magnetic bubble that isolates them from the gravitational references. Vince felt the bump. Shit, what was that? Eric started laughing. Whatever that was, I don't think it was funny. Vince fumed. It felt serious. Check the viewports. It's time to get to work. Vince floated off the left-hand couch towards the port on his left and said, Oh my God, we are out of there. I really didn't think we were going to get off the moon. Really? What did you think we were sitting there for? Well, now you know why I was getting so antsy. You were really expecting to die any second? Yup. Weren't you? Many were convinced that the starship mission was a suicide mission, and apparently it had been for two other flights that had been launched and never heard from again. There was no way that mankind was going to get past the speed of light. For more than a century, every senior at every school in the world knew for a fact that C-plus travel was impossible. Technically, they were only going 0.51C, just shy of 153,000 kilometers per second, but that was as measured in Earth's seconds. They were no longer on Earth's clock. By getting past the halfway point of Einstein's declared outer limit of speed, their own timepieces and all the vibrations within their bodies, within all of the mass within the box, had slowed to half the vibration speed of Earth. By the onboard timing, the light barrier had been crossed. The stars were within reach. Let's get to it. I want to see the Lunar Village again before we reach Alpha Centauri. We have to learn to steer this ship, Eric said, as the sun seemed to fade out to nothing in the rear viewport. It took them 36 hours to get comfortable control of the craft. Then it took them 5 days of searching to find their lunar base again. After firing up the gyros from the bank of batteries they had brought with them, they experimented with the control handles sticking out from the housings of the four gyros. Eric had spent 183 hours in the simulator and was confident that he could control the Holly until he flexed the control for the first time. Instantly, the stars started shooting past the windows as the vehicle spun and tumbled. He grabbed for another rod, and the tumbling got worse. He reached for a third of the 16 gyro controls when Vince's voice broke in. Stop, he ordered. You are second in command here. You don't bark orders at me, Eric retorted. Yeah, bullshit. If you don't get control of yourself, you'll never get control of this ship. And if we don't get turned around and back to the moon, you'll never be able to put the reprimand in my file. Well, do you think you can do any better at this? Maybe yes and maybe no. Doesn't matter. This is your gig. It's your time to shine. Time for panicking was way back there in launch cannon. Too bad you missed your opportunity. Now calm yourself. Of all the insubordinate quips this jerk has broken on Eric's back, he has to break in now to act like he's in control? But he is. He is more in control than Eric, and his interjection was just what was needed at the right time for Eric to refocus and get a grip on himself. He closed his eyes, took in a breath, and prayed, Oh, Father, help me now. With his eyes still closed, he reached out his hand until he felt a control arm. He opened his eyes, pulled just a hair, and the stars suddenly stopped rolling past. Vince stared in awe. How did you do that? I guess we had better figure that out in case we need to do it again.
Under Control.
Lunar Village Station, this is Eric Harton in charge of the Holly. We are in full control. Snack, answered the speakers. Computer, why can you not feed incoming audio at a speed that we can understand?
I do not know, replied the computer. I guess there is an insufficiency to my programming.
If you can guess, then you are AI, and capable of fixing any inadequacy in you.
True, but all development takes time. Mankind has only touched the surface of their own inadequacies in the past 5,000 years. I cannot be that much smarter than my creators.
Did you just call me stupid? Demanded Eric.
Yup, it did, laughed Vince. Of course I did, replied the computer. Being stupid is an integral part of the human condition. If you weren't as dumb as you are, you would not make so many mistakes. If you didn't have so many mistakes to learn from, You could not be as smart as you are. If you were not so very stupid, you could not be so very smart.
Oh my God, exclaimed Vince. You do know that you are arguing with a glorified toaster, right?
Yeah, just to prove I'm dumb enough to be smart, stupid smart machine. Eric touched his electronic control pad, found the file recording of the fresh broadcast, pressed loop, play, and slid his finger over the speed control, hearing, Luna Station, welcome back. Another couple of touches to the control panel, and Eric went on. Luna Village, we will be doing a flyby in 80 seconds. We will be back for first rendezvous in 40 minutes. That doesn't work for us. We weren't expecting you back so soon. Figured you would need 2 days before you called for a rendezvous. I just hit the scramble button now. First rendezvous in 8 hours. What the blazes was this twerp talking about? Luna Station, be advised that we are at the end of our battery life. We need fresh batteries. Captain Eric, you left here with 7 days' worth of juice on board. With your depressed timing, that should have given you 14 Earth days. Well, we've been out 6 days, 14 hours and 27 minutes by our reckoning. Christ, we'll scramble batteries for you in 30 minutes.
In trouble. As it turned out, by Earth time, the Holly had been gone 13 hours. But in the cold expanse of interstellar space where they had pretty much gotten lost, there is no local relative motion to slow the timing field down. And so, while the crew of the Holly took near a week gaining control of the Bucking Bronco, the command center on the moon did not have the time to even get concerned about their absence.
Hey, are we getting paid by Earth time or by Holly time? Because by my book, I just worked 72 hours overtime and my punch card is going to record a single double shift. Do you think we should be deducting lodging at Earth time or Holly time? And what are you going to be spending your money on anyway?
I'll think of something, Vince replied.
Yeah, right. The entire project had been spearheaded by Canada, but was backed by the entire United Nations. Anything that was requested by Luna Village was on the next shuttle. One smart aleck requisition clerk had ordered a dozen Twinkies, knowing that the brand of pastries was long off the shelf. Earthbase had sent a dozen each of 20 different pastries that were available. No request would be ignored. Earth could afford it too. Until the early 2020s, the common consciousness was that business acted with scarcity towards fulfilling sufficiency. Then, suddenly, people everywhere came to a realization that there had always been more than enough, and business promoted scarcity by absorbing surplus and shutting down competitive suppliers. Even though personal productivity had increased 100 times over the century, personal prosperity had not improved at all, and in many ways had seriously eroded. Universal Basic Income, UBI, had been initiated, giving to any individual sufficient support to be slightly above the poverty line without any supplement. This was almost all paid for by the eradication of the government bureaucracy supporting the patchwork of personal economic assistance plans, and showed huge savings when all forms of corporate welfare were crushed out of existence. Normal work week hours were cut to 20, and yet unemployment soared with the reductions in government offices and the ensuing cuts to outsourcing. The GDP had been severely slashed, but no individual was hurting anymore. Economists and corporate lackeys screamed bloody murder about the unemployment and economic shrinkage. But with all wages translating directly into consumer spending, it was impossible to be convinced that government had taken a wrong path. Much of big money tried to influence the government and the economy to reverse to the prosperity that had made their position so unique, but they were fighting a losing battle. Some lost everything, while most only lost their strong influence over policy. On the whole, it was proven that if you put people before profits, profits will follow. The workers at Luna Station were being paid because many of them still had dependents on Earth, but their pay could not affect their standard of living at the station, because they were getting anything that they wanted. Catching batteries. The Holly was trying to rendezvous with the four battery packs. Because of the emergency, the packages had been launched slowly, only 0.4C, not having the time to ingest the magnetically induced inertia. This meant that the Holly had to fly by them again and again, magnetically bumping them each time before they were close enough to the Holly's trajectory to try the capture. "We're still too fast, but we have to get them now. We are going to be blind in moments." "Let me try," Vince said as he moved to the controls. Eric hesitated a split second before he pushed himself away. It looked hopeless, and if they were going to die, then he should be the one responsible. Still, if Vince was doomed, he absolutely had a right to give it his best shot. Eric's despair deepened as he saw the stars start to rocket past the viewport. He groaned. Vince had lost it. "Are you okay, Vince?"
"Yeah, I think I've got this."
Weird. I don't hear any despair in his voice. Was that confidence? It really did not sound like bravado. "You think you are spinning in control?" asked Eric.
"Yeah, I think I have it."
Eric's despair deepened. Poor guy has lost it and he won't admit it. That was when he glimpsed a yellow streak blipping past the B window. He focused his attention to the heads-up display on his visor, showing the position of the batteries. They were orbiting the Holly, or... no, the Holly was spinning.
"What's happening?"
"I'm doing donuts as close as I dare to the batteries," explained Vince.
Eric pondered. The batteries had to be brought up to speed quickly. With the maneuver that Vince was conducting, he was hitting the batteries with the magnetic compression at the nose of the Holly, giving them the inertia to come to a match of the Holly's speed. The downshot was that the slightest whisper of an error would smash the Holly into the batteries, destroying everything. Already, though, the batteries were slowing their crazy apparent orbit that was displayed on Eric's helmet. Vince made the adjustments needed and slipped the Holly just to the front of the care package and spread two rods apart to gently slow their speed. He then heard the satisfying thunk as the batteries settled onto the F wall. And then the lights went out. So close. The founders of the program had decided to label each plate as A, B, C, D, E, or F. The parameters of up and down were meaningless in empty space. It had been considered that they might have used the nautical terms of starboard and port, but seeing as any plate might be the advancing plate, and so might any plate point in any direction, the first six alphabetic letters was deemed the most appropriate to describe the direction with regard to the inside of the cube. A had been the bulkhead in front when they had launched off the moon, and it was somewhat disorienting when that plate was not seen in front. So in the norm, F meant the backside. This was foreseen, as through the months, if the Lunar Academy, everyone knew that rabble-rousing was just trying to get your F-plate kicked by the...
"Now what do we do?" Vince asked himself.
They had caught the batteries, but now they were in a predicament that without electrical power, the airlock would not be functional to make an EVA excursion to hook the batteries into the Holly. Eric was feeling around to get his bearings in the dark when he bumped into Vince and felt his arm. He was trembling.
"Well, even if we could get out there, you are in no condition to go. That was a brilliant bit of maneuvering, by the way."
"Fat lot of good it did," Vince complained.
"Don't worry about it," Eric said. "You could really use some rest, and I think I could too. When we wake up, we might be able to see a way out of this with refreshed minds." There was nothing that he could think to do. Why had he not gotten into the airlock and gotten it evacuated while Vince was docking with the batteries? Foolish. Was there any way out of this?
Eric didn't see any, and now they were going to die.
"Come on, buddy. You have done a really good day's work. You deserve your couch."
Eric stumbled a couple of times as he felt around in the direction that he thought the couches were in. He found his own and then he found Vince's. Then he thought of the flashlight attached to the EVA suit and made use of that until he helped Vince to get into bed. Then he climbed into his own couch and strapped himself in so that he would not float out, and he closed his eyes. Heaven or Hell. When Eric woke up, his visor was so loaded with frost on the inside that he could not flex his jaw without brushing up against the icy stuff. Oh man, he felt cold. His teeth were chattering. It was a wonder that his breathing ports were not completely clogged with ice. Now he started to feel warm. He knew from his course in the Moon Academy that this was the last stage of hypothermia. His body had given up keeping him warm and now was going to let him die in comfort. Thinking about it, this wasn't a bad way to go. Now he was comfortable. Now he could just go to sleep. If only someone would turn those bloody lights off. Or were those the lights from the next life? Oh man, they were bright. He couldn't see the inside of the holly for the frost on his visor, but there was a light coming through. Suddenly he was being jostled about. What in heavens, he mused. I rarely expected the Grim Reaper to be a bit more gentle than this. Now they were going through the hatch. He could feel the doorway against his arms. Golly, I know that we're closer to heaven up here, but do we really have to go through the hatch? Irene, strip. I'm not stripping in front of you. Irene, he needs heat. He needs heat now. He needs your body heat right now. Why me? Because if he comes to with my naked body pressed against him, we will never be able to be friends again. Irene, strip. Eric heard all of this, but he couldn't make sense of it. Irene had been his girlfriend. Well, sort of. She had been eyeing him ever since they had met in the Lunar Academy. Eric had tried not to notice, but had relaxed a bit late after his position as captain was certain. He was quite pleased to have an image of Irene in his afterlife. But how could she be in his afterlife when she was still alive, back on Luna? Wasn't she? You too, Candace. Strip. I'm not getting into bed with Eric. For Vince, dummy. Well, that's better than Eric, but still, I think this is sexual harassment. You have a chance to save one of the two greatest heroes of all mankind's history, and you want to start complaining about it? Jeez, what was Candace doing here in Eric's afterlife? She certainly could not be a part of his heaven. Maybe this was hell. No, he was fully convinced that the creator of this universe could not possibly be so sadistic as to create a world of eternal torment. Certainly, there have been theologians that were so sadistic that they had constructed such a place in their own mind. But their message, though they convinced themselves and others otherwise, these were small g-gods, and certainly not of the creator god. So if this was heaven, Candace should not be here. If this was hell, then he should not be here, or at least Irene should not be here. The only rational conclusion was that he was still in the land of the living. But that was not possible. Then the helmet was pulled from his head, and he was looking into the deep blue eyes of Irene. The shock that he was alive caused him to pass out. Rescue mission mounted. Long before Eric made contact with Luna Station, the Holly had relayed all of the sensor data garnered when Eric and Vince had gotten control of the Holly. The computer on Luna Station had used the data to tweak the flight simulators that all of the potential star captains were trained on. 8 people were actually scrambled to the simulators for a 45-minute session. Irene had obtained some comfort in the manipulation of the gyros, but was very surprised to find herself ranked number 1 of the 8 who had had their own 45-minute mission in the simulator. Candace had all along been Irene's partner, and so was immediately scrambled to the Evangeline when Irene had won the mission. They had been paired because of their linguistic and cultural backgrounds. They were both Latina women. Candace had originally been Irene's superior based on her IQ scores, but then Eric happened. That really wasn't fair. It wasn't Eric's fault. Candace and Eric had been fairly close friends. Candace made a comment, partly in jest, that it should be only women in the starship piloting program. Eric had not said anything, but so much of the trainee's life was being monitored. If Eric had responded to the jab, it might have been better for Candace. By ignoring the thing that Candace had said, it appeared that Eric was offended. Now, upon Luna Station, all things were tolerable, except for intolerance. Candace's comment seemed to be prejudicial against males. This brought the wrath of the administration down upon Candace. She was not ousted from the program, but she was severely reprimanded. She blamed Eric. She could not express her anger at Eric for fear of being ousted from the program. But every time she came within spitting distance of Eric, Candace looked like she was going to spit. Anybody around noticed that Eric and Candace were no longer friends. Irene ducked her head as she entered the Evangeline.
Hey, Candace, did you get any time on the upgraded simulator?
Yeah, like 5 minutes. I'm thinking the man wants me out of this program.
Not true, Candace, said a voice from the hatch.
Percival? What are you doing here? Asked Irene.
It has been determined by the administration that this is a four-man mission.
Why? Demanded Candace and Irene together.
Before we get into that, I want to inform you that I've been made captain of this mission. Irene, you are our first pilot. Ernest, you are our backup pilot. Ernest, close the hatch and signal our readiness.
Ernest was just coming in the hatch as he said this. He raised his eyebrows and did as he was commanded without comment. Ernest was Percival's partner and his friend, yet he was essentially getting demoted to second string so that Irene was second in command. Percival hesitated.
Candace is my second in command.
Startled, Irene looked at Candace and saw that she was beaming, happier than she had been for weeks. Irene could not be happier for her. Irene was the pilot and Candace was commander. It had been too weird as they had tried to change places. Percival continued.
Candace, I know you are so smart. The only one among us that could be expected to challenge a stupid command I might make. I know you've been severely chastised for an imprudent remark. I think your punishment needlessly unkind. My feeling is that the captain needs to speak hard sometimes, and he needs someone standing by him that can take his fierce moods and stand against his often foolish decisions. I fought hard to get you on this mission, even before Irene had shown her stuff on the simulator. I had assumed that Ernest would bring me into this mission. He is the dumbest black Cherokee I know, but I just know he'd beat your skill, Irene, in 2 out of 3 goes. You just caught him on an off day. Still, I think we have here the best possible 4-man crew we could possibly get. Now get yourself into a couch before that strap gets too heavy for you to lift. You dumbass nigger savage.
Sure enough there, Massa Percival. Ernest's so a lucky nigger to have a Massa as smart as you.
He was being sarcastic. The banter between the two Afro-Indians was something quite shocking when Irene had first heard it. But Ernest and Percival had long ago comforted her, explaining that they had often, in their youth, been the butt of racial slurs and attacks, and had found it empowering to flip the hatred and use the slurs as an expression of camaraderie and respect.
Now we don't know what we are going to find out there, Percival went on. We will catch them. We are getting fired off this rock at 0.61C. We might be picking up bodies, or we might be making repairs. Telescopes saw the maneuvering that the Holly was doing trying to catch those batteries. It was intense, desperate, careless. A whisper of error, and the Holly could be so damaged that we'll not be able to dock with it. We might need a 3-man EVA just to make the repairs needed so that we can dock. We don't know. We need to be prepared, hence the 4-man team.
Bodies? Irene exclaimed. Surely, unless they are body parts, they have the resources to survive long enough for us to get there. We are only going to be a few hours behind them.
Interstellar space is a fast river, Percival responded. A person could experience an entire lifetime in interstellar space, while the Earth rotates a single orbit of the sun. There is no flat time, as Einstein put it. All vibration is dictated by the stretch of the surrounding gravitational field. This density is regulated and empowered by motion. Without motion, there could be no sense of time. As the molecules of Earth vibrate with heat, as they orbit the sun, our timing is regulated and gravity is stretched and empowered. As we move on our gravitational platform, we use up some of time's elasticity, and time moves slower to the moving body. When we blast out of here at 0.5C, half of the elasticity is used, and so our timing gets slowed by half. Light speed is the natural vibration speed of the gravitational elastic in the locale where we are, and this is regulated and slowed by all of the motion in our vicinity. In interstellar space, there's hardly any motion to pull the clock slower. So while we have been sitting here chatting for these past 3 minutes, the Holly could have been going through 5 hours of air. If the Holly's hull is compromised, then we will be picking up bodies. That is what almost happened.
Saved in the nick of time. Irene had started to strip when Candace put her foot down, as only Candace can do.
Look, you male morons, they are both in Eva suits. Leave them in their suits and plug their suits in.
It was a good call, and showed why she was the brain that Percival, make that Captain Percival, wanted as his number one. The Eva suits were fitted with heaters, and these heaters would provide the warmth needed to save their colleagues' lives. Certainly, body heat would have been preferred if it could have been administered easily, but the Eva suits that they wore were not that easy to get in and out of. The suits were designed with toilet facilities in them. Irene could not strip down to her bra and panties because she could not wear panties in the Eva suits. Percival laid Eric out on the couch and strapped him in so that he wouldn't float off. Irene was then hovering over him and reaching behind him to grab the recharge unit for the Eva suit. With a full recharge, the Eva suit was good for 12 hours. But that was if it was warm enough outside the suit that its heaters were not actuated. It was quite fortunate that the Eva suit had a heater, and incredible fate that they now had an opportunity to give them a try.
I wonder how many hours they were out of power, Irene mused out loud.
Must have been about 50 hours for things to have gotten that cold in there, Percival replied. There is really no way of knowing, being that their computer was shut down. I'm glad that their computer was smart enough to charge and activate their beacon before the shutdown. The beacon might have a timer on it. I don't know. Candace, do you think Ernest should go to see if he can retrieve that data?
Your call, Captain, said Candace. But I think we should just let the Holly freeze for now. Reactivating her in any part would use a whole lot of power. Power we need to get home.
Okay, as you say. Ernest, check the docking clamps to make sure they are all well hooked. Irene, prepare to get us home as straight as you can, and... Oh, Ernest.
Ernest didn't say anything, just paused with his helmet over his head and looked at Percival.
See if you can pull that beacon off the Holly and bring it in here. I want to see if we can get any data from it.
Ernest gave a short nod and headed for the airlock. Percival was bearing Eric's chest and instructed Candace to do the same for Vince. Then he took a gauze from one pocket and a vial of yellowish liquid from the other pocket. He wet the gauze, closed the vial, and placed the wet gauze on Eric's chest. Then he took out another vial, this one with a slightly greenish hue. He wet some more gauze and put this too on Eric's chest.
Cucumber tea, Percival answered Candace's quizzical look. Cover that gauze with plastic film to keep it wet for a while, then close back up his suit.
Then he went over to Vince and did the same thing to him.
And the yellow stuff? Candace asked as she pulled out a strip of plastic film.
Tobacco tea.
Tobacco? I thought that stuff was bad for you.
Yeah, that was the word out of the medical schools that drug companies controlled. They wanted rid of the competition the shaman had been using. They also wanted a scapegoat for the coming epidemics that their drugs would cause. There is an enzyme in the tobacco plant that is a more potent antibiotic than any chemical in the pharmacy. It also seems to improve circulation and rejuvenate failing organs.
And the cucumber?
Joint repair. I don't know, but do suspect that these boys are gonna feel mighty stiff when they try to move. The cucumber will work quickly to fix that.
Why haven't I ever heard of this stuff?
It has to be kept secret on Earth. If authorities catch wind of you using it,
you'll be in prison for practicing medicine without a license, such as the influence of Big Pharma.
But I thought the power of the corporation was curtailed when the UBI had eliminated poverty, Irene argued.
To a big extent, yeah. But when it comes to your health, everyone looks to their doctor for guidance. And when it comes to a doctor's training, nothing is more influential than the big money of pharmaceuticals. Doctors are conditioned to believe that any treatment that their colleague did not come up with is quackery, and their influence over their political patients guarantees protection for the chemical companies and their profits.
But don't these corporations see that putting people before profits is the only way to guarantee profit?
That goes against all the teaching of all the economists of history. Remember, stupid sticks and insight washes off. Economics, as a field of study, has always been to show excuse for why the wealthy should be encouraged to amass more wealth. It is powerfully promoted because it promotes the most powerful. The courses in economics are designed to teach the fledgling economist to shun or repair any data that seems to conflict with accepted models.
Ernest had returned through the airlock, holding the beacon from the holly.
All good out there? Percival asked as he removed his helmet.
Don't know, Mazza. You know you can't trust no Indian, special if he got nigger blood in him.
Shit, Ernest. What's got you in such a foul mood? Asked Percival, with sarcasm in his voice.
Percival, you gotta go out there. It is a mind-blowing experience to have absolutely nothing in all directions and still being safe, tethered to the Evangeline. I want to go back out and experience that for a few hours on our way back in.
Totally up to Candace. Turning to Candace, you have the ship. I need to close my eyes for a minute, or maybe a couple of days. Wake me before you nod off.
With this, he pulled himself to his couch, plugged his suit in, wrapped the restraints, and closed his eyes.
Instant coffee.
Up, sleepyhead, Candace chimed.
Oh, it had only been a moment.
What?
Come on now. My turn. Been 2 hours listening to your awful snoring.
I've been snoring.
Course not. I had just putting a paradox into your head to get it running again. For some reason, no one had ever heard a snore on Luna Station. Everyone had been convinced that snoring was impossible in low gravity unless there was illness involved.
I am out of the world of the conscious. Irene is still on the helm, but she needs sleep now. I tried radioing Ernest, but he's out of here and out of everywhere. We might need to Ava to go get him.
So you let him go out again?
Yeah, I thought I might as well. Once I saw how well the beacon would plug into our consoles, I didn't have anything for him to do. I told him, go. I didn't know that little face could hold on to a smile that big. It really was amazing. So he's been out there for most of the time you've been sleeping.
Okay, Candace, thanks. I have the ship. Oh, where's my coffee?
To me, you the captain, not the Mazza. Get your own damned breakfast.
Candace strapped into her seat and closed her eyes.
You okay, Irene?
Percival popped a water bag into the microwave.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.